almost done half of the book of Genesis. We've covered quite a lot. What we've seen is we began with the creation, the fall of man, the ultimate rebellion at Babel, and God starting again in Genesis 12 with Abraham. And so with God starting with Abraham, the story is leading us to the birth of a nation that God calls his people. And so as I progress with this story, we need to see that what is going to happen is that ultimately the nation called Israel, God's people, is born. And we're almost there. Today I'm going to cover about three chapters. So tighten your seat belts. It's going to be a long ride. Just to warn you. The focus today moves to Jacob. And so the light is on Jacob and everything that is going to be happening around him. I'll speak from Genesis chapter 28 through to chapter 30 from 1 to 24. Genesis 28, and we'll go through 28, 29 up to 30 to verse 24. So those are the three chapters that I'm going to deal with. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you and we bless you so much. We thank you, Lord, that you called Abraham and that after, through him, O Father God, you raised a nation of God's people. And we thank you that we have been adopted into the family of God and that through Christ we have become Abraham's sons and daughters in faith. And so, Father, help us, Lord, as we look through the Holy Scriptures. Enlighten us, O Father, speak to our hearts, O God. And help us, O Father, to be able to apply God's word in our lives. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I firmly believe and I preach that God is omnipresent, that God is everywhere, and that we can't box or confine God in one building, location, site, city, or even a denomination. God is omnipresent, is everywhere. But as I was preparing this message, it dawned on me that somehow, unconsciously or subconsciously, I have established a pattern. I have established a tradition of going to pray, of going to cry, a tradition where I go to think and make major decisions on the rocks or memorial benches of St. James Beach. Yes, that's St. James Beach. Now, the famous catwalk known as Musimek to St. James, to me, is not just a keep-fit walk along the beach. It is a walk to the place where I meet with God. When I'm feeling depressed, when I feel stressed, when I'm feeling rejected, low, unfairly treated, when I'm in fear or when I'm in doubt, or even when there are prospects on the horizon, or I'm just happy that my prayers have finally been answered, I take all my trials, I take all my praise report along with me to St. James Beach. And so in chapter 28, verses 10 to 22, Jacob is running away from the anger of his brother, who wants to kill him, and is going to meet his uncle Laban in a far-off land with a prospect of getting a wife from there. If you met Jacob at that very particular time, and if you asked him an honest question, where are you at emotionally? How are you feeling? I'm sure Jacob would tell you, I am scared. I am scared. In Genesis 35, verse 3, when Jacob comes back this way, what he says. Genesis 35 verse 3. Then let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make an altar there to God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and has been with me in the way in which I have gone. Surely that passage, as we can see, Jacob recounts this day, and he calls it the day of his distress. He was frightened, he was scared, he was confused, he was depressed. He didn't have a site or a location or a mountain or even St. James Beach where he can run to and seek God and even of Lord before the throne of God. At night, Jacob was tired and he picked a place to sleep. There was nothing special, nothing supernatural, nothing spectacular, nothing superstitious or magical about this particular place he chose. And even the stone that he used as a pillow, there is nothing special or magical about this stone. The ground on which he lay was an ordinary ground. Nothing special about this ground. And so Jacob went to sleep depressed, worried, scared. And at this time, many things are not adding up in his life. Will his brother Esau forgive him? Will he ever come back to his father's house? And what is the point of having a birthright when you can't even exercise the rights of the firstborn in your own family? What is the use of the patriarchal title blessing? And what is the use of being a family leader when you are running away from your own family? And what is the use of the promised land when you are running away from the land of promise? Things are not adding up. Perhaps you have been there. Saturday night you went to bed tossing and turning in depression. And Sunday morning you went to the house of God depressed. And after the service you still came back home depressed. Because apparently the preacher Lawrence talked about the seven heavens and could not address you right at the point of your need. That the preacher was so in heaven that your realities didn't matter to the preacher on that Sunday. Until the word of God touches your heart, it is just an intellectual exercise. God's word is supposed to touch us. If it touches your head, it will not change you. Transformation will happen when God's word touches your heart. And so we encourage each other to come to the house of God. We encourage fellowship, and the Bible encourages us to meet together as brethren. And the reason we meet together, it is not because I cannot pray in my garage, or I cannot worship in my house, or I cannot do anything on my own in terms of worship. No. The reason we come together is so that we can spur one another unto good works. The reason we come together is so that we can encourage one another, so that we can build each other up, so that we can lift one another. As I'm speaking here, and all of us religiously walked in, well-dressed, smiling and putting on that religious smile, we know that deep down things are boiling. Some of you are at the point of breaking down. And when you go home, you must be able to say, I was among the brethren, and I feel lifted. And so those who feel unloved or rejected, and those who want to give up, in this service, they can be encouraged that you must hold on to the cross, brother. Don't give up. What Jacob needs before embarking on this long and lonely journey was an encouragement, an assurance that God is with him and that all is well. Sometimes the biggest help you can give to someone that is going through trouble, it is not the money, it is got the material assistance. It is just you being there. And what I found about funerals is that when someone is dead in your family, you can have all the undertakers in place, you can have the coffin sorted and everything sorted, and yet you can't do it on your own. You need people to stand with you. And people that come to the funeral house to just sit next to you quietly, and you feel, I am not alone. Jacob feels alone. And so in verses 12 to 15, then he dreamt, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and it touched, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give it to you and your descendants. Also your descendants shall be as a dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and east, to the north and south, and in you and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. I'll bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. And so when Eli had this dream of the ladder or the staircase reaching to the top of heaven, the ladder provides a link or a bridge between the man Jacob and God himself. This ladder represents God's providence to Jacob. That after all, Jacob thought he has been alone all along, scheming and tricking. He has not been alone. God has always been watching over him. And so Jesus Christ in the New Testament becomes to us the ladder, the stairway that leads us to the Father. He says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Whoever wants to come to the Father must come through me. Jesus is that staircase. Jesus is the gateway to heaven. Angels ascending and descending. We know that angels are ministering spirits for the good of God's people. These angels never stood idle or lazing around. They are constantly in motion, ascending up to heaven to receive God's command and descending down on earth to execute God's commands. God stood above it, right on top of the ladder. God stood on top of it. God is on top of things, friends. He is constantly in charge. The sovereign God is in control of the affairs of earth from the throne of grace. Then God speaks to Jacob and gives him the following promises. Firstly, God will give to Jacob and his seed. Now, seed. Now, I needed to pause here because I'm super fast. Seed. So every time you hear the word seed, it is talking about descendants or offspring. So in the context of Genesis, every time you hear us say seed, we are talking about children. Descendants. So he says, God will give to Jacob and to his seed the land on which he was laid. Now, land plays a very important role in the Old Testament narrative. It is God's people in God's land under God's rule. It's important that if the nation of God's people are to be established, they need to have a land. And God promises him that the land on which you are sleeping, God is giving it to you and to your seeds. So the promise is not only to the father, but to his children and his children's children. Secondly, Jacob's seed or Jacob's descendants will be so many and countable like the dust of the earth. Jacob's descendants, the Bible says, shall spread to the west and to the east, north and the south. The word spread means to burst forth, to burst forth. Jacob will burst forth. There will be an explosive increase in his seed. Abraham had only one son of promise called Isaac. Jacob had two children called Esau and Jacob. Yet Jacob is going to burst forth and bring 12 sons who later becomes the 12 tribes of Israel. The title of my message is The Birth of the 12 Tribes. Then, that all peoples, now again, peoples, let me pause there, peoples. Now, that all peoples, every time you hear us talk about peoples in Genesis, we are talking about nations. The people groups is nations. So, all peoples or all nations of the earth shall be blessed through Jacob and through his seed. Fourthly, God addresses Jacob right at the point of his need. Jacob is afraid. God gives him a promise. Number one, I am with you. We all need to hear that. We all need to hear that God is with us. Jacob needs to know that God is with him. It does not mean that Jacob will then have a trouble-free or stop suffering lifestyle. A life of no obstacles, a life of no trials. No. What it means is that you may encounter trouble on your way, but be assured that God is with you to deal with those troubles. You are not alone, child of God. God is with you. The presence of God in your life does not necessarily mean the absence of trials, but it means that in the midst of the trials, you can trust God to see you through. In this world, we will suffer. In this world, we will go through difficult things, but be assured that Emmanuel, God is with you. And secondly, he says to him, I will watch over you wherever you go. Everywhere you go, I will watch over you. Now the God of Abraham, God of Isaac, is different from the gods in the ancient Near East. The gods of the ancient Near East were territorial gods. In other words, they can only protect you for as long as you are within the territory. But when you left their territory, you are on your own. So the gods of Musimbik can only protect you in Musimbik. When you leave Musimbik and you go to Fishhook, you'll be eaten by the sharks. Because your territorial gods do not move with you. When you move out of their territory, hey, you are on your own. Now Jacob, however, encounters God at Bethel. Who is with him at Bethel? And who will go with him everywhere else? Different from the gods of the ancient Near East, who are limited. Even today, we build shrines around places where we encountered God. Maybe my St. James Beach, if I'm not careful, can be a shrine. Your local church can be a shrine. Your pastor or even your prophet can be a shrine. Let me explain to us that if you feel that your needs when you pray in South Africa cannot be heard, unless you buy a ticket and go to Nigeria, then your prayers He can answer your prayer everywhere else. And you pray for your brother. You pray for them. They are going through a difficult time. You pray just after saying amen. And then the guy goes like, yeah, I'm just looking for money. I want to go and see the prophet in Mozambique so that he can pray for me, because I hear his prayers are powerful. But I just prayed for you now. You just said amen. But it is not enough, because you have built a shrine in a man somewhere in Mozambique. You have built a shrine in a man somewhere in a territory. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is not limited to a place or a geographical position. He can be everywhere at every time. And God that we worship can answer prayer everywhere. He is everywhere. Down under the sea, God can hear you. Up the highest mountain of Kilimanjaro, He can hear you. In the darkest of the darkest, God can still hear you, because our God is not a territorial God. Our God holds the whole world in His hands. So He will be with you. He will watch over you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. God will go with you. Oh, that is enough. Just to know that God is with you. The same promise He gives him, He says, I will bring you back to this land. The promise that He will be back to this land of promise is very important. At this point, Jacob thinks, maybe it is in a few days, or maybe a few months. But it took 21 long years. What kept Jacob alive year after year was the promise of God that He will bring him back to his father's house. 16 years ago, when I stepped through the borders of South Africa, I had two things on my agenda. Number one, to look for ministry opportunities to do ministry in South Africa. Number two, to look for theological education. I didn't have the money, but I trusted that things would work out for me in South Africa. When I stepped into South Africa, I thought the gates would open. I would have one appointment to another appointment, and I would have some gracious Christian who sent me to a Bible college. It took over 12 years. I worked in Parkwood Garage as a petrol attendant, my first job, walking all the way from Wynberg to Parkwood near Kresimak. I worked as a car guard at Virgin Active in Claremont before they changed that space. I worked there. Can I watch your car? Give you R5. I worked as a security guard in Deep River. And for the past 6-7 years, I worked as a waiter at Harbor House, earning some good tips. I love that job. Unlike security, where you just have to stand on your own and speak to yourself. At least in the restaurant, you get to engage with people. But as I stand before you today, I went through John Wiltfield College, I got my theological training, and I'm here ministering God's word. And so it took 21 years for him to come back to his land. What kept him for 21 years is the promise of God that I will bring you back to this land. When you have the word of God, you can have the confidence to endure action, because you know God is faithful. He will not go back on His word. Verses 16 to 17. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gateway of heaven. And so when he woke up from this dream, dream. God was with me. So Jacob acknowledged the presence of God in that place. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. Ah. You see the reason I don't come from singing? Huh? My singing is so bad. Eh? So when I say I can't sing, I really mean it, you know. But you are awesome in this place. And so that was his confession. He acknowledges that God is in this place. How awesome, fear is this place. This is a reverential fear of God. And then he takes the stone and he used it as a pillow and anoints it and consecrates it with oil and erects a monument. He names the place Bethel, which means house of God. Jacob saw the significance of this place, which he rightly calls the gateway to heaven. This is the first time Jacob is having a relationship with God. It is the beginning of his transformation. He will relate to God, not based on the faith of his forefathers, but as a personal God, the God of Jacob. Jacob makes a conditional vow in which he addresses his deep concerns. If God protects him on this journey, if God provides for him on this journey, and if God brings him back to his father's house, the conditions, the if is conditional, then the Lord shall be my God. If God brings me back, if God does these things for me, then the Lord shall be my God, the God of Jacob. And this stone shall be the house of God, and I shall give a tithe of all my possession. God is not cruel. God is concerned about you and me. He is concerned about our very needs that we have. We are not left alone. We are not orphans. Jesus is in our midst. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He will be with us to the very end of the age. If God can clothe the flowers, if God can provide food for the birds of the air, and give water, God is indeed able to provide food and clothing for us as children. And so Jacob meets with Rachel, chapter 29, verses 1 to 14. Now the well is a strategic meeting place. The well is a place where people got water and animals refreshed. Now, if you're hoping to meet someone, the well would be the likely place. Moses met his wife at the well. Isaac with Rebecca. Isaac's wife Rebecca was found at the well. Jacob meets his future wife at the well. Do we have wells in music? There have been a long discussions about Facebook and people that meet on Facebook. Do Facebook relationships really work? That is the question people tend to ask. And I tend to ask the people the question, where do people meet today? You know, so when Chloe visits us, she doesn't talk to me, she is on her phone. You are with us, you know I'm speaking to Deborah. And when she's with Deborah, she's also... Why do we tend to speak to the person who is not present? This is the world in which we are. People are on internet. Facebook is a well. Be careful. So the stone that covered the mouth of the well was extremely heavy for one to move. But when Jacob saw Rachel, hey, it's amazing how a man can exhibit extraordinary strength when he finds a woman he loves. He can go to extreme length to even pull that heavy stone alone. And so he did. And he failed Rachel's sheep. And Jacob kissed Rachel and cried out, You know, I come from a background where it has, I mean, to just allow myself to be hugged, it has been a very long journey. It's to just, you know, to just be hugged, it is very, 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 very long journey. And I have to deal with all these things. And one time at Cafe Pescados, and I'm working, and it was my birthday, and I'm busy working, and I see this lady that was working with us. She's a married woman, and she came up to me and happy birthday, Lord. She kissed me. I'm a Zambian. We don't do that where I come from. And you know, it hung on me for some time. And I moved to her house from Cafe Pescados, and I was working. And this day, she's coming with her husband, carrying the baby, and she walks up, and everyone, and she comes, kisses me again. Cultural shock. Because to me, a kiss means something different where I come from. But you know, this is the way you showed your family affection. And you will see that even Laban, when he welcomes Jacob, he kisses him with a kiss of affection. And he welcomes him to his home, and he says, this is your home, you are my flesh and my blood. Now there is a difference as we do the comparison how Isaac got his wife in Genesis 24 and how Jacob got his wife in Genesis 29. So when Isaac was about to marry, the father found him a middle man, a go-between. Now this sounds African. We don't just go to marry, we find someone as a middleman to go and do the negotiations for us. You stay far away. And so he sent him to go and secure for his son a wife. Now while Jacob is representing himself all the way, no middleman. In Isaac's case, the middleman has faith in God and even prays for God's guidance, while Jacob's faith is not even mentioned. Instead, he even bargains with God. In Genesis 24, Laban is showered with gifts and money, while Jacob is so empty, is so broke, with no means to even pay Labona bride price or even support himself. When Rebecca comes out, marriage is mentioned immediately. When Rachel comes out, there is no mention of marriage. Jacob was running away. He was not really prepared for marriage. The father didn't send him with a gift or money. And so, fast forward to Jacob marrying Leah and Rachel. Now there are two sisters, and the Bible describes them that one is Leah. She had delicate eyes. I don't know what that means. She had delicate eyes. And Rachel is described as beautiful in shape. And you know, so I don't know what delicate eyes are. But I want to take a view that Leah was a beautiful woman. But Jacob loved Rachel more than he had loved Leah. Now, Jacob's love for Rachel will be a vantage point for Uncle Laban. And after working for Rachel for 7 years, Jacob asks, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled. So Uncle Laban throws a huge party. Their wedding parties would last even for a week. In the night, Laban brought Leah to Jacob, and they went into the tent. In the morning, after the marriage has already been consummated, there is no going back, he wakes up only to be greeted by Leah. Jacob, the deceiver, the trickster, this is the test of his own bitter poison. In life, you are going to equal. There is always an uncle lover for a deceiver somewhere. And he outsmarted him. He says, you know, customer, you can't marry a younger daughter first before the older sister. So, I will still give you Rachel if you want, but for another 7 years of work. 14 years. Imagine, you know, the shops, they say, like, buy one, take two. But this is a different one. You want one for the price of two. So after the end of the celebration, he was then given Rachel as a wife on condition that he works for another 7 years. May I say to you today that whatever you sow, there is a time to reap. What you do to others, others will do to you. This is a clever guy that went and deceived a blind man. But he was deceived with his eyes full. There is always someone who is 10 steps ahead of you. There is an uncle Laban waiting for you on the other side. So whatever we do to other people, let us remember that there will be a time to pay back. The story in 29 verses 31 to 30 is about the birth of Jacob's children. It is clear that Jacob loves Rachel and resents Leah. This will lead to the fulfillment of God's promise of seed or descendants to Jacob. In the midst of the deception between Jacob and Uncle Laban and the hatred between the two sisters, Rachel and Leah, God will work his purposes to pass through this very dysfunctional family. Jacob is going to have his 12 sons through women who are related to each other by blood. And the question of incest is not even raised in the Bible at this point of Bible narrative. Secondly, he marries two women. Again, the question of polygamy is neither commended or condemned at this point in history. But looking at the bitter hatred and the competition between two sisters to please Jacob, one would tell that polygamy is not an ideal arrangement after all. The drama is between two sisters, and the trophy will be Jacob's love and affection. Leah comes into a matrimonial home with a maid servant called Zelpa, while Rachel comes in a matrimonial home with Bilhah. The maid servants are named in the Bible because they in turn become substitute wives to stand for Leah and Rachel. This is a game. You have to score. And so you need to have someone on the sideline, on the bench, just in case you are injured, you can't score. Hey, my servant, come. And so the guy in between who is being pulled is Jacob. And so Leah pulls him this way. Rachel pulls him this way. And so this man who was a deceiver is being messed up by two women and two men servants. Leah gave birth to six sons of Jacob, namely Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and the daughter called Dinah. Leah's maidservant gave birth to Gad and Asher. Rachel gave birth to Joseph and Benjamin later in 35. And the maidservant gave birth to Dan and Naphtali. Rachel's desire for children made her so desperate to get the mandrakes. Let me read the mandrake story. 30 verses 14. Now Reuben went in the days of wheat harvest and found mandrakes in the field and brought them to his mother Leah. Then Rachel said to Leah, please give me some of your son's money, please. But she said to her, is it a small matter that you have taken away my husband? Would you take away my son's mandrakes also? And Rachel said, therefore he will lie with you tonight for your son's mandrakes. When Jacob came out of the field in the evening, Leah went out to meet him and said, you must come in to me, for I have surely hired you with my son's mandrakes. And he lay with her. With her that night. And God listened to Leah, and she conceived and bore Jacob a fifth son. Leah said, God has given me my wages back because I have given my maidservant to my husband. So she called his name Issachar. Then Leah conceived again and bore Jacob the sixth son. And the story goes on. Now, Rachel's desire for children made him desire and so desperate for mandrakes that Reuben brought. Now, what is a big deal about mandrakes? This is an ancient drug, and it was believed to be a sort of love potion. Its properties are good for fertility. Now, this fertility drug that Rachel bought could not even help her. Instead, Leah went on to have two more sons and a daughter. Because the promises of God cannot be manipulated. You cannot use other means in order to get the promises of God. God will give Rachel a son, but in God's time. In 30 verse 22, God remembered Rachel. The word remember is the same word that is used in Genesis when God says, God remembered Noah. When God remembers, it comes down to deliver. And so he remembered Rachel and he gave her a son called Joseph. She said, the Lord shall add to me another son. This was later fulfilled in 35, 17 to 18, when he gave birth to Benjamin at her death. The birth of Joseph signaled the end of Jacob's purpose in Haran. God had accomplished his plans in the midst of deceiving, jealousy, favoritism, hatred, fights. The 12 tribes of Israel are born to him. And so, thinking about St. James, there is nothing magical about that place. I don't encourage you to go there. It is just a place where I go to sit on the rocks and pray and seek God. Yet God, through Christ, has been faithful and he has answered my prayers in that place. For Jacob, Bethel is the meeting place of God, the gateway to heaven. For us, Jesus is the meeting place, the link to the Father. God was committed to do what he promised to Jacob because God's purposes are greater than one man. Jacob came to Laban's house alone. He came broke, empty-handed, but he left Laban's house full with two wives, two maidservants, 12 children, and many sheep and possessions. Laban thought he is taking advantage of Jacob. Yet God was taking care and prospering Jacob. Let us pray. Father, we give you praise and we thank you so much for the entrance of your word that brings light. And so God, we pray that you continue to work on our hearts as we have received this word. And I pray that God, as we go back to our homes of Father, we shall know that God's purposes will be accomplished in spite of our efforts. And so we give you praise and we give you glory that this great salvation that we have, it is by faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen.